Hello everybody. Last week I looked at a selection of performance Renaults, and now we're going to check out three alternative hot hatchbacks for you to consider. And we're beginning with this, a 1990 Vauxhall Astra GTE 16 valve. Now at the time, road testers said that this was the king of the hot hatches. So why is it that 30 years on, this performance icon has been all but forgotten? Let's take it out for a spin. It's strange really, because the 16 valve GTE seems to meet all of the eligibility criteria for entry into the Hot Hatch Hall of Fame. The 8 valve was apparently a bit of a pudding, but this is a totally different animal. The springs were cut by an inch compared to the 8 valve, the rear track was widened by 50 mil, nearly 2 inches. You've got these pretty iconic looks, even though I don't like them at all. My buddy Darren does, so please in the comments tell us who is right. And most importantly, you've got the most legendary of power plants, the mighty Red Top, officially known as the 20XE. This is a pretty hot engine. 2 litres of gas flowed, polished, ported, thoroughbred, nearly race car stuff, and it was genuinely designed as a racing unit. It put out 160 horsepower at a time when the Golf GTI made about 130. In fact, if you wanted a VW hatch with that kind of power, you had to buy the incredibly rare and expensive Rally. Even an MG Maestro Turbo made less power and was more expensive. An Escort RS Turbo made 130 horsepower. You've got lightweight pistons, you've got hollow cams, you've got sodium-filled exhaust valves, technical pornography. Allegedly, it was good for up to 10,000 RPM, but limited to just under 7 for road use. The rev counter is this amazing little creation too. It zips up and down and is part of this wonderfully 1980s dash, even though the car is actually from 1990. And I've got to say, as power plants go, this is a real good un. We've been driving some pretty special stuff this week, including the much more modern Renault Clio 182 Trophy. This is every bit as good as that, if not more special, when it comes to engines. In real time, we've just hopped out of a 2.8 injection Capri, and although this car and that never officially met head-to-head in the showrooms, really it's this car and its brethren that were not so much the final nail in the coffin of the Capri, more a thick layer of about 2 tons of concrete over its unmarked grave somewhere in the woods. And I can kind of see why. The Capri was a nice car to drive, lovely, enjoyable, you get into a rhythm with it, and its engine was pretty decent. This is a whole different thing. Never mind fast then, this is fast now. 160 horsepower and 1,020 kilos? It's quick. Steering's not too bad either. I feel like there's a little bit of play in it, just a little bit. But the gearbox, again, not the most precise, but accurate enough. And that chassis is really quite something. You can indeed heel and toe, and this engine just wants to go. Alright, you can heel and toe sometimes. Pedals are a little bit too far apart for my liking. Oh, and the suspension is epic! Now you do feel like you sat very much on top of this car. These seats are not good. They're nowhere near as nice as even in the Capri, and they are leagues behind, for example, the Clio Williams, which is just amazing. So it's a very odd thing to be in. I really want to be in some nice, comfy, hugging buckets. What this is all about, all this weird stuff that looks like they've kind of pulled apart some beloved 1980s bedroom to furnish the car with, I don't know. But that is not what this car is about. This car is 100% about the drive. Now, I'll be honest, I expected it to be rubbish. I know, I know people that have GTEs, and they've told me for years how brilliant they are, and I've said, yeah, I'm sure it's fantastic and wonderful and great, yeah, and I thought, secretly I thought, yeah, he's talking dog twaddle. I'm sure in about 1990 it was all right, but no. Autocar once called this the Hot Hatch King, comparing it with its then contemporary 205 GTI, the legendary, the reigning champion, I guess, at that time, and of course, the eternal car, the Golf GTI. This really is that good. Capri wouldn't see which way this went. Not a chance. It is the steering that's the letdown. That is the weak link in this package. There's just a sort of a disconnect, and I have a suspicion that that's maybe not a GTE thing. That might be an issue with this particular car. Brakes are nice to use, but in fairness, I actually rarely have problems with brakes on older cars. It tends to be modern ones, which I find worse, because the modern big stuff, especially carbon ceramics, are so grabby and horrible. These are nice, easy to use, easy to modulate, very linear. Oh, it responds just brilliantly. Let's give it some more. It loves this road, it just wants more and more and more. The Capri has that kind of more laid back, yes, get down this road, shall we, you know, whereas this is the more kind of, go on son, give it some, you big girl's blouse. I really didn't think I would like this one. It's been a month of surprises. Well, a weekend of surprises for me, month of surprises for all of the rest of you. There's not a lot of headroom in here, not a lot at all. I mean, I'm not particularly tall, I'm what, 5'10 maybe? And yeah, my hair, granted, lockdown hair still, is touching the roof. So, and it's the seating position, it's all that jazz, that's where this car falls apart. That and the fact that every single piece of switchgear and trim and everything in here is utterly and totally horrible. I can see why the Astra has kind of disappeared into obscurity, because so many of these cars now are cars that people buy because of their memories, because they look at them and this and the other. And I don't know, I look at this generation of GTE and I just go, or generation of Astra, and I just go, that's a horrible looking car. I just don't like it. Even the way they've sprayed the wheels white, so they look plastic and nasty. Now my compatriot Darren is shaking his head so violently, I think he's gonna snap his own neck. But I don't know, and there's a thing to sit in, especially when people want money, you know, you're going to sit in it and go, £10,000 for this? Are you mad? And you're going to walk away, straight away. You're going to go and get into a Golf or something like that, you know, a much more accepted car. This is a real, genuine, forgotten gem. This is, in my mind, one of the best hot hatches ever. I hate to say it. God, what's happened to me? I've just got out of a Capri and I've liked it, and now I liked a Vauxhall. Oh, never live this down. Steering's the weak point. It's just not, you don't quite trust what it's doing. That's where it falls apart, especially in this downhill section, it would seem. You've got to have faith in it, and that's a shame, because the chassis is good. Apart from that, this is a genuinely brilliant car. Thanks for watching. Please like, comment below, subscribe if you haven't already. See you all for the next one. Bye-bye.